It was really like putting a dinner party together.
My wife kept saying, remember now, you're not giving a sermon. It's a wedding, it's a wedding.
One of those potentially dangerous things where you go like, I'm going to put my dream dinner party together, and all these people who don't know each other, but I love all of them, and it'll be great. That can be a catastrophe, I guess.
Anissa, I want to make sure, have you met Jimmy Joe?
No.
Okay, he's one of your inner circle of friends.
In this instance, that's what we did. Just put a fantastic group of wonderful people together. Very diverse kind of mixture from all kinds of persuasions and what have you. But it clicked. It fell into a category of films that I like very, very much as a consumer. I like so-called independent films.
Say nice on whatever the act is. Do whatever you want. But you record that in your style.
For a couple of years while I was doing the larger budget studio movies, I found myself thinking, I wish I had the kind of the courage, as it were, or even the know-how to make a film like that.
Is there like, can we do two stringed instruments? Mm-hmm. With that?
Yeah. Rachel Getting Married. It's a family movie about a girl who comes home from rehab just in time for her sister's wedding. And it's a fractious relationship, and the family's kind of nuts. And it's about that weekend.
Obviously, everything's going to go all wrong. And then Jenny immediately departs from the formula and takes this story in a completely fresh direction.
You want to be as honest as possible. I believed in my characters.
I loved the script. I loved that it sounded like the way my family talks. And Kim as a character, her almost compulsive need for honesty.
You know how I am. I don't wear lilac. It's good to have a principle.
Well, you wore a lilac sweater with a cat face on the front of it on the cover of 17 Magazine when I was
so
at backing camp.
So yeah, they paid me. And I was on horse tranquilizers, so.
I realized that there was one actress who I had sort of literally spotted in a crowd at an awards show. There was this radiant young woman. Wow, who the heck is that? Oh, that's Anne Hathaway.
And then, of course, I found out Jonathan Demme was directing it, and that made me sort of hit the roof.
It was a really good script on the page by Jenny Lumet. It was one of those ones where, when I had the audition, I didn't really even care if I got the job, I just wanted to work on the material.
I enjoyed seeing these funny, smart people bounce off each other.
Hi, Kim.
Hi, Emma.
Seriously, you're so tiny, it's like you're Asian. Mm-hmm.
And then at a certain point in the script, I found myself deeply connected with this family and really hoping things were gonna go well for everybody.
Kim is, talk about brave and honest, she's extraordinarily brave. She's the youngest sister in the family. She has had substance abuse issues.
What can I get for you, Kimmy?
Actually, I'm late for a meeting.
And she's also a pain in the ass.
Kim comes home and is trying to communicate, and the family is trying to love her in any way that they can, and it's about how those two things, which start off very, very far apart, come together to a certain understanding.
People aren't supposed to fall in love with Kim. I hope that people grow to respect Kim. I hope people get a glimpse through Kim of the extraordinary struggle.
We can put Grandma Rose down here with her companion at this other table, which is actually a really good idea.
Where are you putting me? In the stockade?
It was so hard to be in Rachel's skin because you wanted to smack her and kiss her at the same time, you know, Kim. And as we've gone on, that dynamic has been there sometimes super strong. We did this one scene in the sari shop where we're trying on dresses where, I mean, I really thought we were gonna clock each other at one point.
Why is Emma the maid of honor? Why am I not the maid of honor? Because. What does that mean?
Because I wasn't entirely sure when you were coming or if you'd even make it.
When Rosemary DeWitt came in, I wasn't familiar with her work, but I just thought, wow. And Rosemary left the room, and Annie, everybody, Netta, we were just all, let's cast her immediately. So we called her on her cell phone, and she got the part.
Emma's the sister that Rachel never had because Kim was so enmeshed in her own illness.
Emma, would you be horribly offended and hurt if I asked you to step down as maid of honor?
For her?
You know, Kim comes in like a bat out of hell with all of her neuroses and her issues, and I'm sort of, it's like just fiercely defending Rachel.
I've known Anissa since she was a child. I didn't think she'd wind up with a big part in the movie, but I thought conceivably she could be one of the friends if she's interested, and she could learn about being in a film and blah, blah. Well, she came in and did a reading, and it was the same thing as with Rosemary. We didn't want her to get away. We called her up on the cell phone. So I just adore Bill Irwin as an artist, and he also happens to be a neighbor of mine.
I read the script and fell in love with it, but couldn't believe he really was talking about me for this role.
Bill has graced a couple of my films with small appearances, and here finally was a chance to get it all.
Kind of character that I didn't think I should necessarily be playing or wouldn't necessarily be getting to play. Rachel, nobody's defending anybody.
Why are you protecting her?
Because I don't want her to think we don't want her. So it's a stretch and challenge and excitement for me.
Casting on a Demi film is anything goes. He likes real people. He didn't want us just to think actors, he wanted us to think in the theater, New York. That was one of the criteria, that we wanted to work with all New York actors. And to think of musicians.
This is my betrothed, Sidney Williams.
Hi.
The groom, who doesn't have a lot to say in Jenny's screenplay, nevertheless is a very strong presence.
I was touring with my band, and as soon as we got off of tour, we'd all decided that we were going to take a long break.
You know, he's the lead singer of TV on the Radio, so I don't know, I'm not familiar with like a lot of the acting that he's done.
We were just like, well, you got this and this, and you can go in and read for this Jonathan Demme movie, and I was just like, okay, I'll go in and read.
When we did the sort of commitment part of the wedding, he sang a song to me.
He used to work in a diner, never saw a woman look finer.
I was like, yeah, I want to go to this guy's wedding. I want to get to know him. I want to be his friend. And Mather Zickel came in. It was the same thing, and it was just easy.
And this is best man, Kieran.
Hey.
Hi there.
I think any fictional film I've done, I'm very proud of the fact that it visualizes America as I know it. I know couples like this, and I know groups of friends like this.
We have friends of all ethnicities, from all different ages, different backgrounds, different styles. I liken it to this. We were really having a wedding. In fact, I'm not a producer, I'm a wedding planner. We had a wedding, and he invited his friends.
You know, it was almost like his wedding in a funny way. A lot of the people, particularly in the wedding scene, who show up are people from his past. People he's met working, you know, in other projects and friends of his. And
I mean, everywhere you turn, there's somebody kind of fascinating.
There are characters in our own families who, whether they're there or not in the room, their presence is felt. Abby is such a character.
Is your sister behaving herself?
Oh, I'm not exactly sure what that means.
Well, she needs a lot of acknowledgement.
You think?
Come on. It can't be easy, everybody knowing your troubles like that.
I was concerned that Deborah Winger might not be interested because she's doing all this other stuff and what have you, but I got up my courage and I showed her the script, and she said she'd like to play the part. I was intimidated a little bit by Deborah because her methodology, how she does her work, is just ruthless examination and preparation, and I didn't want to talk about the character. I wanted it to happen when we all got together with a camera in the room. She was like, okay, that sounds interesting. And then the day came and we got set up for Deborah's first shot. I was walking by back to the camera and she said, so look, Jonathan, I know that we're not supposed to talk about this very much, but I also know that part of the subtext here, and my adrenaline just, I start like, oh no, like this, and I heard myself say, Deborah, subtext, schmub text, or some articulate thing like that, just do it, okay? And she said, well, you bastard, all right. And I kept walking, and bam, there was Abby.
Hi. Oh, hi. Darling, hi.
Hi, Kim.
Hi.
Come here, honey.
And I don't know what Deborah feels about this, but I think it's a measure of just her native gifts, her extraordinary gifts and stuff. But I like to think that she had a blast doing it in a different way than probably she had done it before and stuff. And certainly on screen, I'm in awe of her.
Oh, everything's fine, honey.
Oh, this is Sydney's family. Sorry. This is Carol Jean. This is my mom, Abby.
There were some parts of the script, especially the rehearsal dinner, where the toasts are given, and also the wedding itself, where Jenny had very artfully chosen the high points and focused in on certain moments in this elliptical approach to the wedding. And in my desire to make it that much realer, I felt we need to experience the entire gathering in order to have perfect truth within the moments we select. So we literally filmed a wedding weekend, trimming this stuff down to a level which made sense for the movie while capitalizing and taking full advantage of the great moments that many people were contributing. That was very challenging in a fun way. Cheers.
I think that Jonathan told the cast that essentially, as soon as they get out of makeup and come up to the set, up to the house or whatever, they're fair game for being shot as the character they are in the film.
We decided to not only not rehearse, but actually truly not know what the shot was.
In this style, Jonathan and Declan have multiple cameras roaming and changing their focus, and so you're never sure whether you're on or not on, and we've all found it easier, sort of less stressful, more economic as far as energy is concerned, to be part of the scene all the time.
There was a lot of footage gleaned in that way, you have a nice shot of them out there in the yard and they're just talking to each other. Go for it.
It was just so exciting. I mean, it really made the cast bond very quickly.
And there are some scenes in there where he shot the whole scene with one take.
All of a sudden at my wedding dinner in front of everybody, you decided to grace us all with your development.
The post-rehearsal dinner scene when the family's all together, they start out in the kitchen, they go into the dining room, the hallway, in the living room, and back into the kitchen. That was always done in one shot.
This one felt a lot like theater because you had to listen every single second there. Distraction wasn't an option.
As an operator, you're in there trying to decide who to cover and how while it's happening, just responding as if it were happening for real, you know.
I wanted all the music to happen in the moment. Where do you live? We did this thing which you're not supposed to do, which is actually play live music while the actors are saying their dialogue.
To know that the movie was being scored live just do you still live? Made me very, very excited and was beautiful to have during the scene.
We generally had two cameras going most of the time for that stuff, and it was almost like two separate units. Jonathan had set up a kind of a B unit that Gerard Sava was the camera operator on, and a separate kind of sound recording team on that. And they would kind of follow the musicians. And very often we'd shoot simultaneously while the musicians are, you know, out on the porch, and we're having a kind of a dramatic scene in the room next door. Quite often the second unit guys would be shooting that while we were shooting the dialogue scenes inside.
There was one scene where Rosemary has a very, very intense monologue.
Our co-producer, assistant director, came over to me and said, "Hey, Jonathan, Annie said that the music's really bugging her this time."
We did the first take and the musicians are playing and I couldn't hear her.
And I was like, well, tell her to do something about it.
Why would anything I said or didn't say at the hospital?
Jesus Christ, are they gonna play all weekend?
Norman! Boys, stop, please.
Ann comes in, starts talking, goes like, God, and does a little fit.
Guys, did you give it
and then the other actors ran out and told the musicians to stop playing. And I loved that happened.
Working with Jonathan has been an amazing experience. Intuitively, we were always leaning in the same direction.
The whole process felt like a gift.
It was beautiful, honey.
Okay. Wait. And it was a huge honor to work with Deborah Winger because I've been a fan of hers for so long.
I was like, wow, everyone's so good. Everyone's so good, and it's really, I just feel really, really, really happy to be a part of it.
I think something very new has happened here, and I think we feel that.
I think people want to be you know, a part of his work.
It's experiences like this that made me want to be an actor. And so I feel very, very lucky to be here.
Where's Kim? Okay. From here.
In daring to try to make the kind of film that has been turning me on for a long time, the off-formula, independent, lower-budget movie, it worked for me. I love this movie. I don't expect everybody else to, but I just love it. And so it's been a great experience, yeah.
That was gorgeous, you guys.